Pensado's Place is brought to you by Avid, Vintage King, Recording Connection.
From a blind shootout to a number one record, our guest will tell you how that works. We've got campaigns from Isotope and AEA. We've got a brand new ITL. It is almost Nashville time, man, and we're excited. You're at the place. It's Pensado's Place.
What's up, everybody? You guys picked a great day to stop by. What's up, Herbert?
I'm good, DP. How about you? Good week?
Man, great week. Great week.
Yep, we're getting prepared, correct?
Well, you are. You've been working so hard, Herb.
Listen, it's worth it. Why don't we talk about
Let's
a little
do
bit?
It.
Okay. Hey, everybody. It is great to see each and every one of you. Hope your week in audio was good. Ours certainly was. Two quick notes for you. Keep those likes and subscribes going. You are making Will Thompson very happy. The show is growing aggressively, and he reports to me all the time about it. Please continue. The more you do, the more we can do for you. So that works. And also, periodically, as a manager, I just take a point of privilege to thank you for all the inquiries in today's mixing services. That's a good thing. Keep that up.
Absolutely.
It's a blessing, correct?
It really helps. I mean, the world we live in, we need that to keep bringing the show at this quality and this level to you guys.
Yeah, and you bring some interesting music from around the globe, and it keeps Dave on his toes. It's a bunch of fun. So thanks for that.
Yeah.
All righty now, let's talk Tennessee. What do you think?
Man, I'm so excited.
right about now, here's what you should be doing. Gassing up the car, getting your passport stamped, put the pets in the kennel, grab your mate, get your behind, tookus, booty, whatever you want to call it. Get it to Nashville on Halloween, October 31st. The Pensado's Place Tricks and Treats Q&A at beautiful Belmont University.
Yeah.
Smack dab on Music Row is the place to be, and we are on our way very shortly. Emails are flying in, but there's still some good seats and plenty of room because I can expand it as much as we want, so keep it coming. Register with your email at pensadosplace.tv/tricks and treats, and you are good to go. Do it now. Don't delay. Hear the details. At 6 p.m. on Halloween, October 31st, Dave and I will be at the Curb Event Center at Belmont U. We'll be there to discuss audio, answer your tech questions. We'll answer career questions. We're bringing a bunch of treats. We're going to talk about a bunch of tricks. We're going to take pictures, shake your hand, and we just want to meet you. Dave and I have fun. We get to meet those folks who support us, correct?
If you've ever been to something that Herb and I are at, we really like hanging out with you guys. And time permitted, we'll stay till the creeks rise and the cows come home. We just
absolutely
we love talking about this stuff.
Yeah.
We love putting faces with these names we see on the internet at Pensado students and some in our page. And
yeah,
everything.
It makes a big difference. So on top of Dave and I, you want guests? We got those too. How about these folks? Charlie Peacock produces Civil War, Switchfoot,
yes.
And Amy Grant.
Wow.
Shout out to your mom, by the way, Charlie. He'll be there. Vance Powell, I spoke to yesterday. His portfolio includes Kings of Leon,
great
Jack
record.
White, Buddy Guy, Leanne Rimes, and more. He'll be there. Had breakfast with my boy, Neil Pogue. He's our boy, actually. Coming up from Atlanta, Neil has done Outkast, Lil Wayne, Travis Barker, and Janelle Monae. He'll be there.
Waterfalls,
classic record. Hey, yeah.
Hey, right.
Classic record. F. Reed Shipman, I had a great conversation with. He's an incredibly diverse talent. He's done Jewel, Keith Urban, Johnny Lang. Also does gospel, does television and film. So for all you TV and film audio folks, you get there too. He'll be there. By the way, Nashville, he's an MTSU grad. So MTSU, this is your guy. You got to show up strong. All these folks will be there to answer your questions and to help out career stuff. You got to take this opportunity. It's really cool. That's not all, though.
I know I'm going to ask a lot of questions.
Me too. Absolutely. We're giving away a ton of prizes. Folks like Isotope and Waves and Avid and Vintage King, McDSP and Audio Technica have just been brilliant for us. I mean,
might have made a mistake, my friend.
What's that?
It's not a ton. A ton is 2,000 pounds. We're only giving away 1,700 pounds.
You know
of
what
stuff.
I did? I stand corrected. Thank you for that.
Now, when the avid box gets in, it might
it'll
make
be
it
2,000. And it's not here yet. So, so check this out. Stuff like RX3, Alloy 2, and Ozone from Isotope, Mbox Pros and Pro Tools 11 from Avid, RetroPack Native Bundles from McDSP, Gold and Program A certifications from Wave. Audio Technica just called yesterday. They're giving us 10 sets of M50S Pro Studio headphones to give to you.
We only need two, one for you and me.
Well, there's actually 12 they're giving us to, but I don't know where the other two went to. come on. I mean, we have to test everything, correct?
Well, you and I really bad about wearing our headphones as jewelry, so it's kind of hard to hide it.
Because we're so hip-hop. Hip and hot. It's going to be a ball. Dave and I almost don't have to show up for this thing to go well. So, bunch of winners, and you may ask, how do you win? Well, you win in classic Pensado fashion by just being outright silly. We're going to have some fun. It's Halloween, so if you dress up, but a bunch of you dress up, we'll pick a bunch of winners for dressing up. If you ask a great question, we'll pick some winners. We want teachers to come. So if you're a teacher, we're going to point you out, and we're going to make sure you win some stuff.
We love the teachers.
We love the students, too. If you rep your school, who came the farthest, best couple, loudest section, wear a polo shirt. I'll pick that one personally. coolest gear nerd, single lady, single man, married couples, best outfit. Dave and I will make it up on the spot. Keep this in mind. It's not just for students. You can be a pro. You can be an amateur. You can work at a studio.
That's
you can be at a music shop. You could just like audio. You could be just curious. Come one, come all. All the schools in around Nashville and around Tennessee, like Vandy and MTSU, Lipscomb, AI, SAE, Tennessee State, Fisk, of course Belmont U, and every place else, come one, come all. This invitation means you. We got lots to give away, lots of fun, and lots of learning, right?
Man, more than right. I am so anxious to get on a plane and head east.
Now, let's talk about the big prize.
Me?
Yeah, exactly. Then there's one other bigger than that.
Oh.
Eight of you guys will be picked to attend a super exclusive all-star reception with many of Nashville's best in class, and I mean best in class. It takes place at John and Martina McBride's legendary Blackbird Studios on Saturday, November 2nd. Pensado's Place is taping a special for Thanksgiving called Nashville Gives Thanks, and we're going to get 20 of the best and brightest in that room and then a reception afterwards, and it provides you a rare, rare insider's look at Nashville country music and how it works. And eight of you will get to hang out with the folks at that dinner. It is truly a treat.
It'd be a treat if the room was empty and you just got to go to Blackbird. That would be cool.
You're exactly right. You're talking about names like Justin Niebank and Dan Huff.
Yes.
Buddy Cannon, Rodney Clausen, both the McBrides, Shannon Forrest, Dave's mentor, Ed C.
Yes, Edward.
John Willis, and many, many more. I've actually only read off about a third of the folks that will be there. And the folks that they've affected and make music for and perform and manage and cultivate and deal with music live for include just about anybody you can imagine in the country world. Kenny Chesney, Taylor Swift, Lady A, Rascal Flatts, Zach Brown, Jason Aldean, Luke Bryan, Willie Nelson, on and on and on. These are the folks that help make it happen. A rare treat. And also, if you take October 31st Halloween through that Saturday, this is a rare triple opportunity for somebody. Come see us, meet some killer guests, get some killer prizes, and also get a chance to spend time and win an opportunity to be with legends. It's really a fun way to learn in advance, and all brought to you by Team Pensado. Right?
Yeah. You know, Nashville is a special place for me because I've always looked at it as the pinnacle of musicianship.
Mm-hmm.
The greatest musicians live in Nashville and work in Nashville. They come from all parts of the country, but they're in Nashville.
Mm-hmm.
And those cats, man, it's humbling.
Yeah.
I thought I was pretty good until I ran into a couple of those guys.
I've learned a ton putting this thing together, I must tell you. So, last time, make sure you're there. Sign up at pensadosplace.tv/tricks-and-treats. Enter your email and the info it asked for, and you are in. Dave and I will see you there. And we just want to mention one other group of people for making Nashville happen. Big thanks, Chad and Chevy and the Nero brothers at Vintage King,
yes.
Jimmy and Brian from Recording Connection,
yes.
Doug and the boys at Audio Technica,
yes.
And our man Ron Dixon of Studio 202 in D.C.
Ron.
Right?
Yeah.
Yes, sir. And honestly, none of this happens without this force of nature on the ground in Nashville. Our co-producer, Stephanie Spitfire Willis for her awesome, awesome,
man,
awesome
Stephanie and John are the best.
Work. They have absolutely killed this. So
it's safe to say this wouldn't have happened without their involvement.
Listen, Stephanie has become my sister. She is an incredible, incredible person who makes stuff happen. Nashville, we're on our way. We cannot wait. Let's talk about Isotope a bit.
Okay.
Right? This RX3 bundle is just killer, isn't it?
Man, I use it all the time. I've found illegal ways to use it. I found legal ways to use it. I mean, it's allowed me to do a lot of things I just couldn't do before. Things that I had to start over, I can just whip that on there. Boy, it's really good.
Let's spin the wheel.
It's musical, too. It's not just a technical thing. It's a musical thing.
What I find is that almost every guest we have just think Isotope stuff is fantastic. We have never anybody who says it's not.
That's true.
Let's spin the wheel, pick up a winner. What did we come up with? Ooh,
Ozone
5. Good one, right?
Use it every mix.
Yeah, do you really?
Yeah.
Our winner this week is Anton Wernberg. Let's give him a round of applause. Anton.
My man. Anton.
Congratulations.
When you get it, check out the basic hip-hop preset.
Oh, very cool.
Monster preset.
Very cool.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, good. Good deal. So, Isotope, thanks to you back in Boston. We're taking care of business. And, Anton, you are a lucky winner. And now to our folks at AEA.
Oh,
right?
Man.
Wes Dooley and Sarah and Julian. We love those guys. What it feels like to me, and you'd have to tell me if you agree, they really have something with this N22 ribbon mic. This right?
It's destined to be a classic. It does so many things really extremely well. It's affordable,
mm-hmm.
considering what you're getting, and it's pioneering.
If you have a home studio or you're a singer-songwriter, this feels like
You put out a little cash up front, but man, over the course of the next 10 years, you can make enough money with that mic to buy the company. Wes out.
There you go.
There's the goal.
That's a hell of a mic.
it is.
So in the next 2 weeks, two things happen. Next week we'll have an ITL that Dave will do. He'll put the N22 through its paces, and you can check that out. Then the following week, we'll have Wes Dooley on this set, sitting in this chair with his top hat. We're going to pull out some names. We're going to have you win some stuff. So the way you enter that, go to pensadosplace.tv/N22. Submit your name and email, and you are good. That simple. You may win an N22. You might win an RPQ 500 preamp. You may win a SMP 17 stereo mic positioner, and they have more stuff. Drawing will be live on air in 2 weeks. ITL next week, drawing in 2 weeks. And you know what? We're going to try to have Wes give us a top hat to send to some people.
That'd be great. I like that.
Yeah, we'll do that.
I don't know if people know her, but at every convention, Wes is the guy you see in this top hat.
Yep.
This exact top hat.
Yep. Great guy.
I think he went bald to AES this time. Oh, I had his top hat.
Well, I have one at my house, so it's very cool. So lots of stuff. Nashville coming. You have the campaigns. We're excited. Dave, why don't you introduce this week's ITL?
I get a lot of requests for how I reference and stuff, so this week's about referencing. Hey guys, a real cool thing happened with some of my Into the Layers. A gentleman named Dave Felton over at Sample Magic thought, man, I like what Dave's doing with these reference things, and he came up with a plugin that's way cooler than what I do. And this plugin is so affordable. I'm telling you, it's scary affordable. And I want to show it to you today. Now, Dave said I inspired him to do this, so I'll take that. This is kind of neat. Now what you do is you load up the plugin. I like it on my print bus, which is where my all my stereo buses come and end up here so I can print it and record it. Now here's the plugin. If you'll notice, I've got an A and I've got a B. So the A is going to be my mix I'm doing now. The B is going to be my references. Now, I can load references in 9 spots. I can click right here. I can select anything I want, and that'll be loaded into that section. This will allow me to set the level on that section. I can do all sorts of things once I get these loaded. Now, the cool thing is, this is a plug-in. I can save presets. So let's bring up my hip-hop preset. Let's play Mystical.
This is what I do. I'm effervescing and I'm up that crescent. Nas is a full-grown German Shepherd, motherfucker.
Okay. Now, That's so cool. Now let's loop mystical. So I can loop between these points.
Shake your ass, watch yourself. Shake your ass. Some of us are working with it. Shake your ass, watch yourself.
Now I can just as easily do lollipop.
Hit your ass on the celly, cause I ain't got time to be arguing with your ass if you ain't really ready. Girl, why you never ready?
Okay. So let's settle on one. Oh, let's go way back. This is a cool one.
Boom, hit me up with some of that thug.
Okay, let's loop it. Now let's say we're gonna let's get this right here. Okay. Now let's go back to the eighth time. Okay, so let's put this thing into motion. I'm gonna play my mix. Now I'm gonna select a song to reference. Let's select Mystical.
I came in with my dick in my hand. Don't make me miss me with my foot in your ass. Be cool. And don't worry about how I'm ripping.
Okay, now look, I've got overall levels here. I've got RMS levels here. I can adjust my reference here and here, and then of course I can adjust my own mix wherever I want to.
For as long as you took, you better look like Halle Berry. Or be at the Corvette, the Ferrari, test the rope. Check them twice, get them good, look, I'm nice. I'm so clean with my G-Unit kicks on. I might be going in, see, get home. If you don't like me, say it to my face. Just because I caught a case, I mean you can't be erased. It must be the ice or the money that I make. Not the Corvette, the Ferrari, test the Rosa. But we can get on any point on the...
I could play with this thing forever. This is so cool. And then if you want to just go ahead and check it against some pop songs, you just pull up your pop presets. The waves keep on crashing on me for...
Shine bright like a diamond.
I'm telling you, this thing is revolutionized the way that we work. And like, if you can tell, here's my old way of doing references. I would chop them up and I'd leave them up in here, and then I'd mute them. I send them to a button on my Avocet, and that works still. But this is elegant because you're not having to store all of this information inside the session. These are saved in their own folder. And it just references this audio, and you can bring up new stuff. Great system. The guys at Sample Magic, hats off to them. They did a really good job, Dave Felton and the boys. Magic AB is a time saver. It's a hard drive space saver, and it just allows you the control you need to really reference at the same levels and do the things that I do with this mess up here at the top in the middle. So, you know, check the demo out. It's very, very affordable. And let us know what you think. All right?
Dave called me at the top of the week and said, man, I'm so excited about this guest. Our guest is literally right now sitting on top of a number one record in some countries around the globe with just a legendary group. won this job through a blind shootout, which is amazing.
Isn't that the coolest thing ever?
Well, it tells you how talented and how bad this cat is. Ken Andrews. Welcome, man. Thank you for coming.
Good to see you, Ken.
Dave, what you got for Ken?
Man, Ken, you know, your group failure where you started, God, that was like, what, 20 years ago?
Yeah, 15, 16.
Yeah. So influential, and the general public hasn't quite caught up to failure yet, but Fantastic Planet, ooh, I listen to that at least once a month when I need inspiration. We just showed the ITL. I'm a big believer in if you're doing a particular type of song, don't reference in that genre, reference in another genre. I like doing that. So I listen to that song a lot, that whole project a lot. So some of the people that aren't familiar with you, the three that are out there, give me a little capsule of how, because you came into this business a little different route than some of us other mix engineers, and you're much more than that. I apologize for that.
But yeah,
bring me up to speed.
Oh, I came at it from an artist point of view. Mm-hmm. I was in bands basically. Mm-hmm. Failure got signed in '91 mm-hmm. to Slash Records here in Hollywood. Mm-hmm. We did three records, and the third record was the one where we kind of took the reins as a band, mm-hmm. and mostly me twiddling the knobs and doing the mixes and the recording and engineering part of it. Mm-hmm.
I got a little teary-eyed when I saw that you were working with a cassette four-track. Was it a TIAC?
I had a TIAC first, and then I had Tascams.
Gotcha.
But man, people don't know how lucky they really are. I don't want to sound like my parents, but that was torture working with two four-tracks and bouncing back and forth and stuff. That was your first record, and the label wanted to put that out.
Yeah.
It must have been good.
The only thing we didn't like about it was drum machine, mono drum machine. Mm-hmm. That was just a placeholder for us. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. But looking back, the label kind of saw something. They saw the magic in those demos, and we actually ended up releasing those demos on a sort of a retrospective thing called Golden. Mm.
And your formal training was in film, not audio, right?
Right. Yeah. Failure was sort of like just a hobby thing I was doing on the side when I went to film school at Cal State LA. Mm-hmm. And then I think we were about maybe 15, 20 shows into our existence as a band in 90, 91. And I hadn't graduated yet, actually, from school. And the drummer came up to me after the show and was like, you know that there was like four A&R guys at the show tonight. And
I was like, what?
Oh, who's playing after us? He's like, no, they were there to see us. And sure enough, we got a record deal a few months later.
It's kind of weird because when I listen to your work on the new Paramore record, by the way, congratulations, fantastic body of work. When I listen to your work on that, it has, especially the mix part, has a visual element to it, in particular, like on the song Now, the way you, like the guitar and the bridge, just you move things around. You're painting kind of a, and I hate to use that word, but it's kind of a visual landscape, the way you pan. I can kind of see your brain going, visualizing something, mm-hmm, you know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm very into using panning as dramatic scene changing. Mm-hmm. Usually you're going mono small into stereo big, but recently I've been kind of going the other way. Mm.
Does the side of your brain that got you to film school, is that part that sort of continues?
I think so. I mean, all you know, for me, I've always looked at the whole creative process as kind of one thing.
Mm-hmm. Precisely.
And the industry really separates it all out.
Which
you know,
is crazy.
You're an artist, you're a mixer, you're this or you're that, but for me, it's always kind of one thing, including the visual aspect. So like during when Failure was together in the 90s, I had a big say in our videos too, mm-hmm. and what was going on there.
You directed quite a few videos too.
Yeah, I directed a few videos, yeah. Mm-hmm.
I think you're the archetype for the modern producer because I don't think division of and separation of the project to different elements to have control. I think that's kind of a 1990s concept, don't you think?
It's funny, I've been talking to a few people about that. They're saying that the specialization or the hyper-specialization of certain fields is mm-hmm. ending.
Absolutely.
And, you know, being a jack of all trades, maybe not a total expert in all of them, mm-hmm. it can be a valuable thing. So mm-hmm. yeah.
It's almost like being a team leader, like you fill in with other people the things that you feel can be enhanced by having a partner, right? You said that you like to go from big to small, but on Now you didn't go from big to small. You went from small to big.
Yeah.
And I'm going to point it out to you because this was one of my favorite things on that record. The first verse, you got me kind of mesmerized with this little guitar slightly to the left. Cool sound.
Mm-hmm.
And by the way, I got another question I just thought about. Then in the B section, you bring in another guitar on the right. And mm-hmm. I'm thinking, man, these guitars are big.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden the hook comes in. And they really get big. And I love what you did in the hook. How did you make the guitar so wide? Did you use any kind of spatial thing?
No, I don't think so. I think it makes it seem wider because they're almost mono in the verses. So
yeah, you set me up big time.
Yeah, that was something I actually discussed with the guitar player before the whole project started. Is that, like, when it's just one part, where do you want to be in the stereo field?
Mm-hmm.
I'm thinking like 30 to mm-hmm. the left.
Mm-hmm.
That was just a thing I felt. I always feel like starting left to right with the story of a guitar, like
Me
you're
too.
Reading.
Mm-hmm.
Also, there might be something slightly weird with my right eardrum. So I think I put important things on the left to me.
Mm-hmm.
That had a racquetball hit me in the ear at high speed and it actually punctured my eardrum.
Oh, sorry. How long ago?
About 8 years ago.
So you've done a bunch of this really seminal work with that.
I was mixing a record when that happened to me. And this whole ear went out. I mixed that record with this ear pointing towards the two speakers. It was a very weird experience.
Wow.
At least I had done four of the songs first.
Mm-hmm.
So I sort of established the sound of the album. But it was
I bet
very
your visual
strange.
Background really helped for that, huh?
Yeah. I was looking at the meters to see where things were
sure.
panned sometimes, because
sure.
sure. I couldn't really hear the pannings of it.
Hmm. The bass on Now is kind of a hook in and of itself. Like most people would tame it, kind of smooth it out, give mm-hmm. it a little bit of a classiness, and you just let it be rude and ugly.
Yeah.
Let me ask you this. The guitar, the bass, and that had a lot to do with you winning a shootout with four other really A-list engineers to get this, didn't they? When they heard what you did, your treatment on the bass, I bet that was part of what they liked.
I think the aggressiveness of those instruments helped, and it was I listened to the other mixes, and I think, yeah, mine were maybe a half dB more present. Mm-hmm.
It was a blind shootout, too.
Yeah.
They didn't know who was who.
I love that, you know? It's
At least
it's
you know
a very honest thing, you know?
I think so, too.
Yeah.
I agree.
And did you consciously try to stay close to the rough, knowing that that's kind of a good way to get on the good side of the people making the decision, or did you go, I'm going to live and die by what I do, that's what I'm going to do?
No, I stayed close to the rough because I'm really good friends with the producer. I knew what they were going for mm. from the beginning.
So you cheated.
Yeah, basically. I visited them in the studio while they were recording. Oh. It still ended up being a blind mix-off yeah. thing, but it gave me a little bit of an advantage to see what was important to them.
So
while they
blind
were
with benefits.
Yeah,
blind
yeah.
with benefits.
Gotcha. A little bit of pre-cheating, yeah.
So, in a way, that might be a technique to take into your future projects, to go in early and listen and then incorporate some of those ideas in the last part of the process, like mixing, right?
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah, for sure. Yeah, that's. I mean, those guys work really hard. Paramore is a very hardworking band, mm-hmm. whether they're writing or touring, whatever. They think about every aspect of their recordings, every aspect of how the mix is going to turn out.
Mm-hmm.
So trying to go left of center from their rough, I knew was not going to play well with them.
Right.
Because they're very, you know, they knew what they wanted.
Right.
In terms of our audience, I don't think they understand that you and I and people that do what we do, we basically go for a shootout, through a shootout, every time we get a job, because there's everybody that's being considered and they choose us, that's a form of a shootout, right?
Oh, yeah.
What from this shootout process would you say a guy at home could take from your experience of something negative that you learned from the shootout? In other words, not what not to do as opposed to what to do.
Hmm. Well, I think it comes down to the rough and knowing what the band's headspace is. Mm-hmm. I mean, I followed Paramore, you know, through their whole career. I knew they were going for a sound change on this. So I would say kind of, you know, just basically do your homework, you know. Know where the artist is in their career. Are they looking for somebody to really like unlock a new sound for them in the mix? Or do they just want what they have, you know, enhanced?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I read somewhere that Paramore was heavily influenced by failure, by your group Failure. So
yeah.
Did that factor into your process? In other words, did you think, well, let me just be me, but older me or newer me or?
No, because that's the sound they were going for was a very not a failure sound, except on one song. There's one song on that album. I think it's very might be second to last.
Still
or
into
last.
You?
No, it's not a single at all.
Huh.
Deep cut. Mm-hmm. It's almost an homage to Failure. Mm-hmm. It sounds like something we would have done back in the 90s.
Did you record in Nashville or out here? Did you mix? Where'd you do it?
I did it out here in my studio. Yeah.
Gotcha. Cool.
Let's continue the studio thing. You pretty openly have espoused and championed the in-the-box process for a long time, haven't you?
I would say the first year that I did it, I was a little wary of telling people.
Mm-hmm.
The 3 or 4 years ago, if you said it openly, people would be like,
yeah, but the four guys you beat out, I happen to know they're all console guys.
I know.
And you weren't.
Yeah.
In a blind test, the box won.
Yeah, I think the mixer wins on any piece of equipment.
Great point.
You
know? At this point in the technology involved with mixing in the box, I really don't think that there's any hindrance or handicap or advantage.
Mm-hmm.
Other than the advantage that I find is just a workflow advantage.
Mm-hmm.
I find that I'm just a little bit closer to the music.
Mm-hmm.
I don't have as many knobs between me and the song.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Or there are a lot of virtual knobs, but you don't have to see them all the time.
Right.
You're kind of just looking at the
mm-hmm.
song there,
mm-hmm.
and it's more direct somehow.
To help your efficiency?
Well, yeah, greatly.
Yeah,
because you can template. You know, effects, chains, and stuff like that.
Yep.
So,
you're not even going out of the box to some. You're staying in the box, except for an outboard piece here and there, right?
In the 3 years that I've done in the box, the first year was outboard summing, and then on accident, I ended up listening to a couple comparisons of my own mixes out of the box and in the box, and I couldn't tell the difference myself. They were so closely level matched that I could not pick them blind myself. I had my assistant set up a blind test for me, and I could not consistently pick either one.
Wow.
I need a favor.
Yeah.
I get asked a lot, how do I make all these various elements coexist in the mix? Now, you had an endless collection of mid-range instruments to deal with.
Mm-hmm.
On the Sound on Sound article, I looked at the track sheet. It just looked like 60 mid-range machines.
Mm-hmm.
And you did a masterful job of keeping the synths where they need to be, all the guitars where they need to be, the vocals. Can you share with us a technique, or is there a technique, or is it just a little bit of massaging over the course of days?
Yeah, it's the cumulative 1,000 decisions that you make in a couple hours, really, I think.
Mm-hmm.
The real challenge on that one was that, like you said, it was guitars, Haley's vocal, and the synths. The synths were not a big part of their set until this record. Part of the reason they went with Justin to produce it is they wanted his electro vibe.
Mm.
He played a lot on the record.
Mr. Justin, he did a great job.
He did a great job. Very methodical on that
record. So were you using like if I were mixing that record, I would prioritize. I'd say, okay, the vocals got to win the battle, the guitars have to be a close second, the synthesizers, you take what's left over, and then I'd start EQing. Did you find one particular EQ worked better for the process of getting these to work together? Did you use tight bandwidths or bigger bandwidths? You had to use tight, right?
I had to use tight on the synths. I definitely went for, like you said, I prioritized them before EQing, vocal, guitar, synth. Uh-huh. However, there was a lot of points where I let the synths take over on the guitar, and not necessarily feature, but you felt them. Mm-hmm. A lot of cool kind of sequency parts. Finding the mid-range frequency to boost on the synths when I wanted them to poke mm-hmm. was interesting, because it was based on the sound of what the synth was doing. A lot of the times it were quite low, like, you know, 500.
Yeah. Hmm. I noticed the synths, you used them a lot in little breakdown areas, little bridges before the vamp. Mm-hmm. There's one that just pans to the right, kind of like moves real cool. Mm-hmm. Was that in So Still Into You? Was that the bridge in that, or was that in Now?
A lot of, it's probably most of the songs.
Oh, okay.
You know, when Justin sort of took the album before he added the synths and sat there with him and the guitar player, I think did the synths together basically. Mm-hmm. But they threw the kitchen sink at it basically. Mm-hmm. They did a little bit of weeding before they gave it to me synth wise, but they wanted me to kind of weed as well. Mm-hmm. So if there was a lot of creative muting, it was mostly in the synths for me, mm-hmm. some of the guitars. Okay. A lot of those, like, where it sounds very automated and stuff, Justin did that.
Oh, cool.
I would say that there were quite a few songs where I wasn't really having to do that much, because it was so well recorded and so well planned out. Wow. Some of the bridges, though, where it was like 10 or 12 synths all in stereo and two or three guitar parts, not even playing rhythm, like three melodic guitar parts. Those were the parts where it was like, okay, how am I going to figure this out?
Mm. I want you guys to listen to Now, the song Now by Paramore, and then rerun this part of the show, because I think this is important. I was really struck by the delays that you used on Now, especially mm-hmm. on the vocals. Mm-hmm. You tend to not hear that in a song or a group like this. You know, you tend to hear these on a more pop record, but the first verse, I guess it's in the first B section, the echo on the word all, mm-hmm. the way you did that.
Mm-hmm.
What did you use? Is that Echo Boy?
Echo Boy is definitely my echo of choice. Uh-huh. I usually have two to three of those, maybe four of those.
I love that echo.
Yeah. I don't remember that one.
And the choruses, did like when she's holding those long notes, did you do like a quarter note, half note delay or something to kind of stretch those?
Oh yeah,
that
for
was
sure.
Spectacular. Yeah. I want you guys to check that out.
I usually have two quarters, one just the delay and one feeding a reverb as well, mm-hmm. for really long extensions.
Mm. And philosophically, when you think, okay, this needs an echo, what are you trying to solve with an echo? Are you trying to fill up a space? Are you trying to create some kind of tension release thing? Or
yeah, and on that record, a lot of it was creating some sort of tension before chorus three comes back in, basically, uh-huh. right?
Oh, okay. And how did you carve out, I'm going back to the bass, because I'm not gonna lie, that's my favorite part of the mix, is the bass on
yeah.
Now. I can see.
That's a killer riff.
I could see myself destroying that bass. That's why I like what you did, because you let it be proud to be what it was.
Yeah.
You didn't put it in a better piece of clothing. You didn't try to get it to go on a diet. You just left it just kind of.
Well, that song in particular was a very difficult mix, because it was very harsh.
Yeah.
Almost all the sounds were so aggressively recorded that when you just kind of put it up, it did not mix itself. Some of the other tracks
did. Was it part of the shootout, that song?
That was the song.
Oh, was it really?
Wow.
Which I thought was a really good choice by the band, because it was by far the hardest one to mix.
Yeah. How did you get the low end on the bass to work with a kick? Like that's another question I get so often, mm-hmm. and I never hunt for either one. They're right there, and the kick sounds great, by the way, on that song. Did you
kick?
Do you remember carving? I hate the word carve, but did you leave little holes for both to sit in, or do they just work?
I don't really do that. Actually.
I don't either.
It's
I don't
so strange.
Why I ask that question.
People always talk about that. Like,
Herb told me to do that.
Yeah, make room for the kick in the bass, and even panning the bass a little bit, and panning the kick a little bit. You know,
I think
the kick is occupying a huge frequency range. Sure, its peak is lower, mm-hmm. but it should cover. There's an attack and all this other stuff. So. I just kind of tweak until they are working. I definitely will solo those two instruments, mm-hmm. but I never really like go, okay, on this song I'm going to have the kick at, you know, 120 to 80, and I'm going to have the bass higher. Mm-hmm. It's more of just like what's working for the riff. Mm-hmm. And on that mm-hmm. riff, you needed to have an ugly, really, I even added more compression and overdrive to that sound to get it to really speak.
Mm. Did you happen to use the one that
the Sound Toys one?
Yeah,
Decapitator. Yeah, no, and the only reason I didn't is because I think they used it already on a lot of the bass sounds. Mm.
On that mix, I feel like the poor little bass guy. He can't bloom because he gets in the guitar's way.
I know.
He can't go low because he gets in the kick drum's way. And I tell you, guys, listen to that bass. I'm ranting and raving about it, but I was pretty impressed because that's a big problem.
It's funny, that song, even though I won the shootout with that song, we revisited that mix several times during the rest of the mix of the album.
Really?
I think mix 8 of that song is what ended up on the album. That was a hard one.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow.
Really.
I noticed in research about you while you get ready for Batter's Box, relatively recently, you sort of made a concentrated effort to use social media in ways. Was that a branding exercise? Does that have to do with the music? What was your thought? Didn't want to be left out because everybody else is doing it?
Pretty much.
That's it, right?
Yeah, I mean, you know, and just, you know, I've got little kids now.
Exactly.
I don't want to be like, you know, the guy who
doesn't
know how to use Facebook.
Right, exactly.
You know,
exactly.
When my kids come of age. So, yeah, it's a part of life now.
It is.
And,
it is.
You know, everything, like my assistant, to him, it's like, you know, why aren't we Instagramming this right now? Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And I'm still like, it's just a bit of a generational thing still for me.
When we moved to this studio, we're now at Stream Studios in Hollywood, it was really difficult to move this desk in here. Mm-hmm. And the staff did a great job of it. And we had to get rid of a bass that we used to sit on a bass. So mm-hmm. our team threw it away. And one of the guys that rides with me, we were riding by the dumpster where the bass was. And he said, Herb, let me take a picture of it. I was like, for what?
Yeah.
And he Instagrammed the picture, and within 10 seconds, oh, that's pieces of the Titanic, and you should have broken up and sold it to us, and just
right.
Amazing.
Right.
Like, you just, you know, I think Dave and I oftentimes were kind of all gee-golly wow about the show, because we're just constantly mm-hmm. blown away at the reaction and the interaction and all the stuff that can happen by utilizing tools. But I think it has a really real effect on how guys we're talking to deal with their careers today. And some guys can have it affect the music in a bad way. Mm-hmm. You have to have a meter on what you do with it. You know, you have to define how far it helps your life and then when it can start to hurt your life.
Yeah.
I think, don't you think?
Yeah, because it can consume you.
I know a lot
of people who it just takes over their whole.
They're addicted.
Yeah.
Nobody talks about this, but we're now in an age where you have to know when to bail. Like, if you stay with MySpace too long, you screwed up.
Yeah,
that's for sure.
Not only you need to know when to get in, you need to know when to get out now.
Absolutely, absolutely.
Because you can look silly.
Before you start that, tell because I know you have a great affection. Tell us your feelings about M83 as an artist and just.
Oh, I've been following him forever.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean I have all his records. My wife and I are just huge fans. Mm-hmm. So, and I've met him a couple times through other friends, but this year was the first year where I actually. Got to work with him. Yeah.
Great experience.
Oh, amazing.
Yeah.
Amazing experience. He's a great, I always figured him as kind of like a very maybe not difficult artists, but just very detail oriented mm-hmm. and maybe hard to please. Turns out he's super pragmatic.
Really?
And just very easygoing.
Oh, nice.
And a perfectionist. He likes it how he likes it.
Sure.
But he'd never, you never spend more than an hour or two fixing something.
Nice.
You know?
Oh, that makes it a great experience.
Oh, it's so awesome. Yeah, yeah, yeah. So awesome.
All right, Mr. Pitcher.
I am ready.
It's World Series time, so get up the heater.
For this.
I've been getting my ass kicked for 3 years. I don't know why I'm doing this.
Throw the first.
Not do this. I never win one, Herb.
You have one.
Wait, it's a It's a competition.
No, it isn't. Oh, okay. We make it this.
Yes, it is.
No. Okay. Fire away there.
Vocals.
Wave C4.
Mm. Ooh.
Crack.
Stereo bus.
Right now, the Slate tape emulator.
Cool. Synthesizers.
Virus.
Mm.
Old one.
Our boy, the bass.
Bass guitar or synth bass?
I'll take either one.
Bass guitar, Wall. W-A-L, 1L, Wall bass.
Mm.
Very awesome bass guitar.
Drums?
Gretsch.
Okay. Mm. Echoes or delays?
Echo Boy.
Mm-hmm.
Also a big fan of Space Echo, the real one.
Oh, cool. Reverb?
Altiverb.
Yes. Island plug-in. If you were standing on an island, what one plug-in would you take with you?
C4 and Phoenix. I know it's two.
I love Phoenix.
Phoenix is just crazy.
Mm.
Guitars. Not a brand. Give me something, a plug-in or a outboard gear.
Fractal.
No joke. That's a headline, Herb.
No doubt.
You got me.
Yeah.
Wait a minute. I got one more.
Oh, you got one more.
Distortion.
Okay.
Distortion. It's not Decapitator.
Devil Lock?
Devil Lock. Devil Lock 2.
There you go.
Yeah.
Ooh.
I got the free one. I got to get the 2.
Oh, 2 is awesome.
I'll give it to him, Herb. He won. He kicked my ass.
He got the Boardwalk Empire Award.
Fractals. I thought I could tie the game and go into overtime, but Fractals,
there's an assassin quality about Ken. There's a guy on Boardwalk Empire who's an assassin, and he's actually missing half his face, so there's no expression. And Ken has that, I just murdered you.
He set
you.
Me up. He went for sympathy with the ear thing, and then he came back.
And boom.
Blammo.
Like he does with his mixes.
Caught me off guard.
You're very unassuming, and bam, he has knocked your ass unconscious. Good for Ken.
Good for Ken.
Thank you.
Absolutely.
He'll never come back. We might as well.
Let's introduce our man in the corner office. He is known as Chongor. Chongor, how are you?
I'm doing great, man. How are you?
You're looking good with your background of orange there.
I have to try.
Okay, good. Chongor, you got some questions for our guests?
Yeah, of course. This first one's from Chad Mikkelvenna. On the Paramore album, the snare and kick room sounds really make the drum sound. Were they sampled, and how did you treat them in the mix?
They were not sampled. They were recorded, and there were two sets of them. Close and afar, and they were awesome. They sound like they were pre-EQ'd, and they were just so nice.
The whole album, you only used one sample on one song, right?
I think I used a kick sample, like on maybe half of it, as a blend.
Yeah.
The actual room sounds were recorded, and they were recorded well by Carlos, the engineer.
Yeah, but Chad's right. The drum sounds on that record are, I mean, I'm looking for little spots I can steal them and clean them up with my RX3.
You know what he does? Because I called him right away when I soloed them. I was like, how'd you do this? And they were baffles or gobos, mm-hmm. and the mics behind them.
The room mics?
Yes.
Wow.
I'm like, but they're not that dull. And he's like, yeah, but you can add a little bit of like 2 or 3K and it makes it perfect and it cuts down on all the cymbal wash.
Chongor, mm-hmm. give us another one.
From JDC, what was the vocal chain you used on Haley, and did it change depending on the song?
Oh, I'm glad you asked that, because I forgot to ask that.
I'm not sure if I'll remember the exact order. Wave C4 is definitely in there. I think I had a simple high pass first, like a Avid one band EQ.
I think you used an R2.
Okay. C4, then probably an LA3A or 1176 CLA.
The blue stripe?
The blue, I would change depending on the song. How strident her melody was. I would use the black if it was really strident and the blue if it wasn't, because the blue sounds brighter to me.
Yeah, the blue feels like it grabs a little quicker too.
Yeah, It just sounds more aggressive overall. Yeah.
Chungor, two more, what you got?
Brian Rotella, did the absence of Zach Farrell make it harder to get the Paramore feel?
That's a good question.
Questions.
They weren't going for the Paramore feel. Basically, they were going for a new Paramore feel, so it wasn't hard, no.
From Scott Neufeld, how do you balance your work life with your personal life, especially with having children?
That's a good question.
Holy cow.
That's hard. That's why I was asking Dave about studio spaces, because my studio space is on my property. Yeah. It's not in the house, but it's close enough.
Makes it tough.
And it's hard.
It's tough.
It's great sometimes, because you can just walk out and be in your life.
Yep.
And other times you walk out and you're in your life and you don't even have like that 15 minutes of transition from, you know, mix world into daddy world.
I read somewhere that you like to work in like blocks. So you do a 3-hour block in the morning, 3-hour block in the afternoon, a 3-hour block after everybody goes to bed. Are you still doing it that way?
Yep. That works for me.
One of the things in all this preparation for Nashville that has been interesting is how they work in Nashville. It's a job. It's over at 6 o'clock or 9 o'clock or pick your toy.
But they start early.
Well, but whatever it is, they cut it off and they go. It's not overnight. They come home and have families and stuff. But we actually, Dave and I have been talking about doing a show with spouses, because their role in what you guys do, what we all do, is so critical. It's so complicated, don't you think?
Oh yeah, mine is an artist herself.
Yeah, so that's a whole other level.
Yeah, it's a whole other level.
Unbelievable. You know, Ken, one of the things that is so cool is when you're talking about Paramore, Nine Inch Nails, or Beck, or Pete Yorn, and stuff that is, you know, your bailiwick and your taste, that's such a special part of our audience. And Dave and I sort of we pride ourselves on what we do on the show and what we do outside the show. So can we bug you to come do some of the stuff we do outside the show?
Sure.
Your point of view and your expertise, it would just be great for our audience.
And
we want to make sure more and more people know about what you do and your skill set. Thrilled to have you. Goes by fast, doesn't it?
Yeah. It was great.
Will you good come times. Back?
Of course.
Man,
love
what
to.
A pleasure.
Yeah.
What a pleasure.
Great time.
Dave, before you wrap it up, guys, just a quick one. Last week at AES, we were one of the sponsors of a cool thing at Chung King Studios for our man Chevy. A bunch of people showed up, so we'll run a little bit of that over the closing credits.
I read that went really well.
Yeah, so Dave, wrap it up, and you'll get a little piece of the AES shoot of the AES Afterglow party.
Okay. Hey guys, I said earlier in the show, you know, go check out the new Paramore album. Please do that, because these answers were heartfelt and they were very candid, and thank our guests for that. And you can learn a lot by, sometimes when I listen to the guests, I'll go back and listen to the record again, even though I spent months with it already, and I learned so much that way. It's a great way to learn, and we're just so blessed that we have these cats that come on and share this stuff with us. So light up their Facebook pages and make them feel happy, make them feel like you really appreciate what they're doing, and we'll see you next
Get to Nashville.
Hell yeah.